So there's this building in the middle of Croydon, and it's a centre for people with an inherited disease called sickle cell. And there's these paintings on the side of the building of red blood cells. The healthy, happy ones are dancing and playing football, but there's also these sad, pale-looking ones. And there's one in particular in a hospital bed, and it's shaped like a sickle. I used to drive past this building all the time as a kid, and without knowing it, I essentially had a basic grasp of what sickle cell was. But despite the paintings on the building, I didn't grow up with that many people talking about sickle cell. However, it wasn't just me.
So I knew something was wrong with me, but I didn't know I had sickle cell anemia. I would just randomly have pain in my back, or my legs would give way, or my arm would give way, and I can't play PE today. But I didn't know why.
But how is that even possible? How could someone like Lola grow up not even knowing she had sickle cell? It's one of the most common genetic disorders and affects millions of people around the world. So the big question is, why aren't we talking about it more? And what's with the stigma? So what is sickle cell? Well, it's actually the name of a group of blood disorders, but the most common one that we'll be talking about in this video is sickle cell anemia.
How would I describe it to someone that has no idea what it is? It's where your hemoglobin or red blood cells are shaped abnormally.
This is a healthy red blood cell. It's round and flexible and flows through the blood vessels easily. But this is a blood cell produced by someone with sickle cell. It's not round. It's more like a crescent moon or a sickle. And the problem with blood cells like these, besides the shape, is that they're rigid and sticky. They get stuck in small vessels and block blood flow and oxygen to the body. We call this a sickle cell crisis. And yes, it's extremely painful.
It's the worst pain any human can experience.
Excruciating pain.
It feels like I'm being stabbed.
Imagine being stabbed by like a million different knives.
Really digging in there and like twisting the blade.
You can get that pain anywhere in your body.
A scorpion with like blades attacking your bone.
It feels like I'm having an exorcism in my sleep.
And it's not only the extreme pain. There's a number of other severe complications that come with having the disease. Managing sickle cell means lifelong treatment, which is usually in the form of medication and pain relief, supplements like folic acid, and blood transfusions. There is actually a cure though, a stem cell transplant, but these aren't done for absolutely everyone for a few reasons, partly the cost, partly health risk factors. As far as genetic diseases go, sickle cell is one of the more common ones, and it predominantly affects people of African descent on the continent and across the diaspora. But if this is true, why are there still stories of people with sickle cell growing up not knowing about it?
My mum didn't have a sit down with me explaining to me what my condition was.
At first I was angry because I knew my parents were taking precautions against me falling ill and all of that. But it was like, oh, you didn't really tell me why you were doing all these things.
I didn't know anyone experiencing this same illness as me. And I didn't quite understand it myself fully at that time.
To me, it was anger at first, yes. And then trying to figure out, okay, how do we go from here?
There is a stigma attached to sickle cell, and a lot of people don't feel comfortable talking about it because of the lack of knowledge surrounding it.
Nigeria has the highest rate of sickle cell in the world, with an estimated 150,000 babies born with sickle cell anemia each year. But despite the prevalence of sickle cell in countries like Nigeria, some of that stigma still sticks around in some cases, and part of that could be attributed to historical and spiritual explanations about why sickle cell happens and why it was taking the lives of so many children.
There's actually a term in Yoruba that basically used to be used for people with sickle cell, which is the children that come and go.
The term is Abiku in Yoruba, and in Igbo, it's Obanje. And these terms often refer to a spirit that predestines a child to die early and be reborn again and again. And while modern advancements in medicine has given us an explanation as to how sickle cell works, some of the stigma still sticks around.
Sickle cell patients are kind of seen to be less than, or to seem to be being attacked by the devil or some enemy somewhere. It's heartbreaking, you know, to hear that and have to navigate that.
People, you know, didn't have access to education, didn't have access access to healthcare. You're having babies that were born 1 minute, good 1 minute, and then they're dead the next.
The communities that tend to still believe in spirituality of it are the rural communities, but they're getting better.
That's Dr. Annette Akinchete, Director of Sickle Cell Foundation Nigeria.
Don't forget the psychosocial aspect, because it's just as important as the physical illness. When you notice that there are issues, there tend always to be issues that we deal with that are psychosocial, because of stigma, because of discrimination. These are things they deal with every day of their lives.
So what can be done to reduce the stigma of sickle cell and improve the lives of people living with it?
We need to sit down and iron out all the stigmas and stereotypes within the community, within the African community.
More funding, more awareness. We can't just keep talking about prevention. There are also those of us living this life, and you need to find a way to make sure they are living like the best life as much as possible.
We're so used to suffering in silence. I think that's something more than bigger than the sickle cell community, bigger than the Black community. It's a condition that we've learned over the years to deal with. So it's really hard to sometimes have this conversation because people feel ashamed or a sense of guilt. There's a lot of trauma around not talking about our pain. I'm now comfortable with knowing that it's okay to not be okay.